Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. And I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. And I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. And I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy.
This is Soul Cafe Radio, food for the mind and soul.
Greetings, friends, and welcome to Soul Cafe Radio from the Heart for Monday, February 22nd, 2021. This week, we are concluding our series on February. So today we want to look at, and we'll be looking at it for the conclusion of the series, Romans chapter 8 from verse 31 through 39. Today we're primarily focused on verse 31, which says, "What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?" And our title for our brief talk later on is, "If God be for us." Please join me as we have a word of prayer to begin. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you, dear Lord God, for your being good and merciful and kind. Thank you for your graciousness, O God. This morning, Father, in the name of Jesus, I just want to thank you and praise you. I just want to glorify your name, O God. I want to give you the glory that you so richly deserve. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Thank you for hearing my cry. Oh God, I thank you so much for your loving kindness, your tender mercies. Father, this morning, or whenever else time, oh God, that any person is listening to this, I pray that you'll bless the listening audience. Father, I pray that what they stand in need of, that you will supply, and that there'll be no distance, oh God, between their souls and their Savior. Father, I pray for today's presentation as we conclude our special emphasis for this month of February here in 2021, that your people may be ennobled, uplifted, and edified, I pray. Father, bless your words to our hearts, we pray even now, in Jesus' precious name, amen. Right before we get into our morning devotional exercise, we want to pause and just play a song just to get us ready for the words that will be coming forth for today. So at this time, I'm going to pause and play a song, and then we'll come back with the message for today, If God Be For Us.
Has somehow forgotten that you are faced with circumstances you can't get through. Right now it seems that there's no way out and you're going under, but God's proven time time again, he'll take care of you, and he'll do it again.
He'll do it again.
If you'll just take a look at where you are now and where you've been, well, hasn't he always? He can calm the storm and he'll find a way to fix this for you, and he'll do it again.
He'll do it again.
If you'll just take a look at where you are now.
Yeah.
What a beautiful way for us to begin our time together here this morning as we contemplate the words of Romans chapter 8 and verse 31. At this time, we'll get into our morning devotion, which is taken, as always, from the heart. Today's date, February 22nd, 2021. And I just want to say, I don't think I mentioned it earlier, I just want to thank each and every one of you, whether you're tuning in live or listening to the rebroadcast, and I want to take this time out to just tell you, not just to listen, friends, but to download the podcast. It will be greatly appreciated. So don't just be a listener, be a downloader. From the heart, February 22nd, the devotion reads, and the scripture reading is Luke 18 and verse 24. Our topic is godliness with contentment. How hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. Luke 18, 24. These words of the Savior are deeply significant and call for our earnest study. Many who possess great wealth have obtained their riches by close dealing, by benefiting themselves at the expense of their fellow human beings, and they glory in their shrewdness in closing a bargain. Every dollar thus obtained and increase of every such dollar has upon it the curse of God. Wealthy men and women are to be more closely tested than they have ever yet been. If they stand the test and remove the blemishes of dishonesty and injustice from their characters, and as faithful stewards render to God the things that are God's, to them it will be said, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." No man can serve two masters, Christ said, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. When the Pharisees who were covetous heard these things, they derided him. But turning to them, Christ said, "Ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God." Writing to his son in the gospel, Paul says, "Godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." Paul will impress upon the mind of Timothy the necessity of giving such instruction as would remove the deception which so easily steals upon the rich, that because of their wealth they are superior to those who do not have such large possessions as themselves. They suppose their gain to be godliness. There are high and holy interests which call for our money, and the money invested in these will yield to the giver more elevated and permanent enjoyment than if it were expended for personal gratification or selfishly hoarded for greed or gain. What a thought. Now, usually I don't take the time to comment on a devotion unless, like we did last week in our extended study, we looked for the whole entire session from the devotional thought. But today's presentation, today's devotion is a little bit different. It calls for a commentary, dear listener. In fact, what comes to mind right now is the fact that so many of us are caught up in worrying about our houses, worrying about our bills, worrying about this, that, and the other, looking at interests, which, let me just say, are not to be neglected, but our primary interest, our primary purpose in these last days is to be looking towards the celestial city and to be making heaven our home. Friends, our chief goal right now is to be developing a relationship with Jesus Christ. And when all these things are in place, when your treasure is set where it ought to be in heaven, when your heart is set upon whom it ought to be, King Jesus, then friends, he promises that all these things will be added unto you. So I do not want you to become discouraged. I do not want you to become disheartened. I don't want you to be out there believing that you have to become so all consumed with these things. Because as we shall see in a little bit, if God before you, nothing, that's including all those things that you got to face on a daily basis, they can't be against you. This is the word of God, and I promise you, God will not fail, as the song we played said earlier.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work.
Say no weapon formed.
weapons formed against you shall prosper. Praise God. Again, our scripture reading, taken from Romans chapter 8 and verse 31, tells us that if God be for us, who can be against us? Friends, who indeed is against us? Many people will take all day to fill in this blank, and they will add names upon names upon names upon names. But in reality, the Bible tells us we only have three main enemies: the world, the flesh, and the devil. And our greatest enemy is indeed our own selves. So therefore, if we have learned to eradicate the self from the equation, then in reality, we would have eradicated the all who is against us. Even those external forces that come against us will have no sway, will hold no power, because God would be for us. You see, friends, the Bible even tells us in Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 7, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. And there are multiple scriptures that could be added in there, but we just want to focus on that point. You see, friends, one day soon, Satan will fall. One day soon, all those who have come up against you as enemies will go into oblivion. But friends, there is one ultimate enemy that, if he is left standing, will cause you to join your enemies and the chief of all enemies in oblivion. And that, of course, I'm speaking about yourself. So, if God be for you, who can be against you? An absolute truth, friends. And that's why it is so vitally important as we go throughout this week that we remember this. You see, friend of mine, as we contemplate on these eternal realities, it is very important that we make God for us, that we sweep away all the cobwebs of defects of character in our lives, that we unbar the door, so that Christ can have full access to our lives. Don't have him peeping in. Have him invited in. Have him being the honored guest, dear friends. If God is for you, then no one and nothing will be able to stand against you. No weapon that's formed against you shall prosper. That's the word of God, and I pray that you dare to believe. Last thing I want to say on this is simply, again, the scripture says, if God be for you, then who can be against you? No one, nothing. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And remember, friends, don't be misguided. There will be weapons formed. They just won't prosper. Tongues will come up against you, but they will be condemned. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, my friends. This is his pledge and promise to every believer out there. And if I was you, I would take God at his word, because he fully means it. He fully means it. And I pray by the grace of God that you'll trust him to do exactly that which he said he'll do, because at the end of the day, friend of mine, I'm telling you, you will want no other person to be fighting your battles for you. And so, as we begin this final week of February 2021, I encourage you, I challenge you, beloved, to make God your ultimate friend. Like I said in the devotional exercise, there are many things that we could be focused on right now, but our chief aim, my friend, our chief aim is to be developing a relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you for what you're doing in the hearts of your people. And I pray that as we meditate upon our future, dear God, as we contemplate what lies ahead, help us to know, dear God, that if you are with us, then no one or nothing can come up against us. And if they try, oh God, they will indeed fail. This is your promise and pledge to your believing saints. May you continue to bless your words to our hearts, we pray, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Friend of mine, as I get off the air, I just want to remind you to check the description area for how you can support this ministry continually. May God bless you as we count down as we conclude our series on February 2021. God bless you.
Just ain't one.